Greetings and welcome back, fellow audio enthusiast. And for this review, we are going to be covering off on the Philharmonic BMR V2. Now, Philharmonic Audio, I'm of the opinion that there are two camps. Either you know who Philharmonic Audio is as a brand, and Dennis Murphy more importantly, or you've never heard of them before at all. When it comes to Philharmonic Audio, it doesn't exist without Mr. Dennis Murphy. Now, Dennis Murphy happens to be the former crossover guru behind many of the Jim Salk sound designs. As a matter of fact, Mr. Murphy was responsible for the much-loved and well-received Song Tower from Salk Sound. Mr. Murphy's a pretty no-nonsense crossover designer, and so much so, as an accomplished violinist, he has a knack for building probably some of the best value-oriented products that I've seen in my 11 years in the audio industry. I became familiar with Mr. Murphy's design, let's say about 2014-2015. As I started lusting after wanting to own a pair of Philharmonic 3s. Now at that time, the Philharmonic 3s were pretty large. They were actually a four box design speaker, two to a side, and they had a 8-inch Revelator in a transmission loaded design bass bin. And sat atop that was a large planar mid-range driver with the ubiquitous ribbon tweeter. At that time, I still remember quite vividly that for me to, living on the West Coast, to own a pair or at least demonstrate a pair, it was going to cost me over $400 in shipping. And that's just not a box that I could easily check at that time for an in-home demonstration. So that never happened. As many of my subscribers know, when I was living in the apartment earlier this year and last year, I was moving through several stand mount designs looking for something that just really punched above its weight in its class and could give a very good presentation in a small space with a small form factor. More particularly when I was covering off on the Dave Fabricant Ascend Acoustics design series, I had several subscribers who were reaching out to me saying that I must review the Philharmonic Audio speaker, the BMR, because of its value factor in the space. Now I will admit, I wasn't in a rush to have to buy a brand new pair because let's face it, these speakers just do not come up often on US Audio Mart or Audiogon or anywhere else. And when they do, they generally command a higher amount of their original retail value, as well as they don't last long on the forums to begin with. So it came down to, for me to review this speaker, I ended up having to go all in and buy my own brand new pair. While buying this pair, and I placed that order in April of this year, something happened. Something changed. While waiting for my pair and going through the forums, I had noticed that there was talk about a new SB acoustics driver going into the BMR. Knowing how good the old BMR design was, and myself looking forward to hearing the 34 hertz dig that was capable with the ScanSpeak 7-inch driver that Dennis had used in his designs, I became momentarily cautious, curious, and maybe even a little bit miffed that I didn't know that there was going to be a design change in the middle of my order being placed. This is Mr. Dennis Murphy that we're talking about. And the man knows how to make an incredible crossover, and he knows what he's doing when it comes to speaker design. And so I need not worry too much. And that brings us to the form factor of what this Philharmonic BMR is here next to me. We have the now very well known RAL 6410 ribbon tweeter. Then there is this interesting little piston driver here that gives the Philharmonic its namesake. This 2.5-inch Tektonic balanced mode radiation driver performs the mid-range duty handoff and is what gives the Philharmonic BMR its name. Then there's this newcomer to the playing field, the CA17 6-inch ceramic driver. This driver continues to give the Philharmonic BMR an impressive low dig into the 36 hertz region. So you have a 36 hertz all the way up to 20K cutoff. The form factor of the speaker itself is quite large, and it weighs in at just over 28 pounds. This is the curved cabinet. This is the curved cabinet option, not the standard rectangle cabinet, wood cabinet. Not the standard rectangular wood cabinet you could get and save about $100-$150. No, I went all in. I wanted the rosewood curved cabinet from Mr. Murphy. And this speaker, brand new, shipped to my door in Idaho, ran $2,000. As I had mentioned about my curiosity of the swap from the ScanSpeak driver at 7 inches, a pretty good woofer, to the smaller 6-inch unit, I'm going to cut and paste a direct quote from Mr. Murphy when I reached out to him and just had to ask why the change and why the 6-inch versus anything else that he had to choose from out there. And you can see in his own words, along with his own graphs, when testing the two side by side, just how impressive this little 6-inch driver is and how flat the frequency curve response is when designing a crossover that was going to optimize his beloved design. Here you go. Down to that performance metric. Let's get down to how I feel the BMR performed versus the 20 other speakers that I've owned in my stable. Many of my subscribers know that I keep a scorecard of all the stand mount speakers that I've owned. The reason why I keep a scorecard on only the stand mount speakers is because I'm also of the opinion that that is one of the most competitive spaces in the audio kingdom. Creating a well-defined, a well-performing two-channel small stand mount speaker with most of the time only two drivers in a small form factor has to be one of the hardest things to do because there are literally thousands of models out there. There are thousands of models with hundreds of brands to choose from. And the price points themselves have to be incredibly competitive just because of the total package expectations and vying for consumer dollars. So it goes back to, I started my little grading chart early on when I brought in the KEF R3s and the ADS L780s, And then especially my number one speaker, the best stand mount speaker that I have yet to judge every single speaker by, the Totem Acoustic Element Fires. To this day, that is the high watermark speaker that I have personally owned. Not only was it an incredibly well-researched product, but the handmade torrent driver in the Element line is in itself a masterpiece of a driver. The fact that it's crossoverless, it is just incredibly articulate, and the reaction, the speed, the finesse is just, it is unique to the Totem Acoustic Design series in of itself. Then there's my number two favorite. My number two favorite, the newer comer, is the Rubicon 2, the Dolly Rubicon 2. There is just something incredibly special with the design and the marriage of that wood pulp driver. There was something I just couldn't stop gushing about when I reviewed the Dolly Rubicon 2s. The wood pulp driver, there was a timbre, a tone. There was this palpability that was a very unique sound signature I had not heard from any other brands at that time up to that point. The Dolly Rubicon 2 really gave me something unique in the space, in that when listening to woodwinds, when listening to percussion instruments, and even other some guitars, there is just a tone, a warm, not lush, but just a kind of like there was a ring to it. Something, again, that I would just say that was very unique for the Dolly lineup, that wood pulp driver. I adored that sound. Now, with the Totem Acoustic Fires and the Dolly Rubicons, you've just got explosive speed, dynamics, range, and tone. I can safely say that my last couple of months with the Philharmonic BMRs, these speakers uncannily split the difference between my two favorites. This SB Acoustic driver, not only does it have this incredible tone like the Dolly Rubicon, but it has an inherent speed that is just so impressive, much like the Totem Acoustic Fire. I have to admit something to my viewers. I punished these Philharmonic BMRs. I really can't think of any speaker that I pushed as hard as I did for a stand mount, mind you, as I did these speakers. When it came to the movie scores, when I got to Hans Zimmer, Pirates of the Caribbean, I cranked these speakers up and continued to push them harder and harder and harder. And they did not give up. They did not cry uncle. They stayed absolutely composed. And yet I couldn't believe the explosive dynamics that I was hearing from these speakers, especially for their size. And it pretty much goes like this. I did one of these. I became a slack-jawed yokel, ogling an 80s square body Chevy sitting in my chair. I just had this look about me. I couldn't believe the room energy. I couldn't believe the bass that I was feeling at the seat of my pants with this little 6-inch driver. How on earth were these speakers sounding so large and so, I say it, explosive in what is a rather large listening space that I have? Some of the smaller tower speakers that I've used have not filled my space the way that these speakers did. With my 11-foot high ceilings and the wide space that they're allowed to play within, I was just absolutely dumbfounded at what Mr. Murphy was able to accomplish here with this three-way with this three-way pair. Speaking of the sound pressure levels, I just continued to crank it up when I brought up Danny Elfman's Batman theme, and I cranked these speakers up past 95 dB, pushing on up to 100 dB. The horn section in that particular track, there is just something so special about the brass section. That's one of my favorite tracks when it comes to fleshing out brass tones. And these speakers had the absolute right amount of that brap, that metallic context, that metallic throatiness. There was this timbre that I just became intoxicating listening to through the BMRs. They are a very well sorted speaker, and at no time was I hearing separate drivers. The little piston mid-range just meshes so well, bringing together the SB and the Rawl tweeter. And it seems like there's a very small window that Dennis has that little guy playing to do that quick handoff from how high the SB acoustic can play and how smoothly it can play, going on up to where the Rawl tweeter feels very comfortable above the 4000K range. So yes, there is no doubt while I am a huge fan of the Ascend Acoustics 2EX lineup and that speaker in particular, while those are very quality drivers, and it is the same ribbon tweeter we're working with here, this little guy does a fantastic job of marrying the two upper and lower ends together. And you are just greeted with this incredible soundstage. It is not forward, it is not the deepest, but there's just something I will say that is very honest with these speakers. These drivers, they start and stop with just alacrity. They are incredible. The ribbon tweeter, again, there's not much I need to tell you guys about it. I love the ribbon tweeters. With the crossover, it works very well in my space, and it worked very well with music scores, with large orchestral music. However, being a hard rock fan, I could equally turn on the 60s, 70s, and 80s hard rock and just let it play loud, and it didn't hurt my ears. It didn't attack me. It didn't feel like there was no level of stridency. Hard rock is not smooth, so I'm not going to say that there was a smooth presentation. But there was a level of finesse not present with many of the other stand mount speakers that I've played hard with. As much as I definitely love my green Performance Ones here, the Performance Ones, when it came from top to bottom, is no match for the BMRs. So as much as I even love these speakers, in the nice roll-off of the 3.5-inch paper driver, the detail and resolution retrieval of the BMRs is so close to those Totem Element Fires that it's, and I would say, almost unfair that someone would need to spend $6,000 to reach that extra 5%, to reach for that extra 5% of top-of-the-line resolution. Now, you're paying $6,000 for the Totem Element Acoustics because of the Torrent drivers. Those are handmade, crossoverless, ultra-special drivers. And that's what you get with small batch designs that have that level of R&D in them. Dennis, with all of his experience, especially at Salk Sound, he could take off-the-shelf parts and know how to magically mesh them together with his crossover designs. And speaking of the crossovers, no electrolytic caps in the crossovers. As a matter of fact, have a very large poly cap at the upper end of this crossover. Quality parts through and through. And yes, the cabinets do come from China. There has to be some cost savings somewhere, folks. I dare you to find a better performing stand mount speaker for $2,000 or less. As somebody who's looked high and low, and I love the Dolly Rubicons, but the Dolly Rubicons start at $2,500 without stands. Those are probably as close as it gets. Let me close on the Philharmonic BMR this way. As I go through and I looked at different music for different tones and different instruments, what would these speakers be uncomfortable with? Now, the obvious, they're not going to play organ music, guys. I don't use subwoofers. I play speakers as they come, as they're built, as they're shipped. So yes, if there was a limitation, organ music's going to be the limitation. But when it comes to a double bass, these play it to 36 hertz. You've got the double bass covered. Cellos covered. Baritone sax covered. Brass instruments absolutely covered. Like I said, that's where the Rahl tweeter does do its job well, and you're going to get that metallic sound with a nice low end that this SB Acoustics driver can give you. You want to hear the ringing echo of a xylophone. These speakers are going to give you that. What I will not say is at the end of the day, these come incredibly close to being a do-it-all speaker if you're still even looking at lower end stand mount. I mean, especially if you're looking at lower end floor standing speakers. For those of you super budget oriented folks, do not go out and buy brand new $1,500 floor mount speakers. I can absolutely, assuredly, with all confidence, tell you that these blow away floor mount speakers that you could buy brand new off the shelf for $1,500. They'll blow away speakers, they'll blow away floor standing speakers at the $2,000 range. I've owned speakers in that price range that don't produce the bass, the contextual, well-resolute bass that these speakers can provide you. I'm telling you. You have to spend more than $2,500 to come even close to reproduce the type of bass that the BMRs will give you. Now, if you really need to fill a large room, a floor standing speaker is the way to go. If you want to spend the money on let's say, a Rel subwoofer, now you've got your organ music covered. And I don't know what kind of money you could spend with a high quality Rel subwoofer and the Philharmonic BMRs that's going to replace them, that could sound better than them, that could give you the smiles per miles that these speakers provide. Hands down, these are the strongest, second best performing speakers I've owned. Hands down. I've gone on and on and on about how much I like the Ascend Acoustics Sierra 2EX. I've gone on and on about the performance ones here. I'm telling you, these are special for a reason. And I will say these have to be the most underrated stand mount speakers I now know of. For $2,000, I haven't heard of a speaker come so close to those $6,000 Totem Acoustic Element Fires. That's where I'm going to leave this. My hat's off to Dennis Murphy. The V2 are an incredible speaker. He found the right parts and he married everything together in an incredibly cohesive package. And yes, these speakers even made my Denon DRH-800 tape deck sound really good playing 1990s Queensryche. It is now time for me to close this video out. I absolutely appreciate you spending all of your quality time with me. I let the cat out of the bag several weeks ago, and I've been quietly and methodically spending time with those Avalon Acoustics Radian speakers. I am going to be selling most of everything that I have left and focusing specifically on the Radians for a while. It's not often that buyers like us on the secondhand market get to come across such an incredibly well-built speaker. One that all I can think of is I just want to spend more time with it. I just want to come home and relax and each night get a good hour of listening time in, appreciating those speakers for what they are and wanting to elevate the front end electronics to squeeze every ounce of the mega performance that they already provide me. I really just want to enjoy those Avalon Acoustic speakers throughout this coming winter and not focus so much on what's the next several pieces of equipment that I can bring into my system. And for a while, I'm going to be stuck enjoying the top of the line 1990s equipment for what it is. May you enjoy your families and may you appreciate what you have for the 2021 Thanksgiving year. Thank you and have a great week.